This is a 2006 Jaguar XJ Super V8, and it was the ultimate luxury Jaguar back in 2006. To create this car, Jaguar took the supercharged V8 from the high-performance XJR, and they dropped it in to their most luxurious long-wheelbase luxury sedan. And that meant this had all the power and all the luxury. Think of it as Jaguar's version of the Mercedes S63 AMG. And today, I'm going to review it. Before I get started, big news, this XJ Super V8 is currently for sale, being auctioned live on Cars and Bids, my enthusiast car auction website. This is the ultra luxury version of this car, and it has low miles, it's been in California its whole life, and with one owner until earlier this year. So, when you finish watching this video, click the link in the description below to head over to the live auction for this XJ Super V8 on Cars and Bids, where you can bid on it and win it and buy it only on Cars and Bids. So let's talk Super V8. Jaguar came out with a new XJ full-size luxury sedan in 2004, and it was a huge leap forward for the brand. It had aluminum construction and way improved technology, and frankly, it generated a renewed interest in Jaguar. This particular model, the Super V8, was the top-of-the-line Jaguar luxury sedan back then. It had a sticker price of around $95,000 in 2006, which is about $130,000 in today's money. Like I mentioned, it used the 400-horsepower supercharged V8 from the XJR, but the XJRs were all short-wheelbase models. In this car, they combined the performance engine with the long-wheelbase Jag and all of its luxury amenities. Of course, these days, depreciation has kicked in, and this is a lot more affordable than it once was, although it still has its stately, luxurious presence, as you can see. And today, we're going to find out what else it has. First, I'm going to take you on a thorough tour of the XJ Super V8 and show you all of its interesting quirks and features. Then I'll get it out on the road and drive it, and then I'll give it a DOUGSCORE. All right, I'm gonna start the quirks and features of the XJ Super V8 with getting in, and that means starting with the key. Now at first glance, it just looks like a fairly standard folding key from this era, but the cool part is to unfold the key, you push the Jaguar logo, this Jaguar face, you press that and then the key pops out, which is kind of a cool little piece of attention to detail. Also interesting with this car is the key itself, which you can see is kind of like a cylinder, not like a flat key like basically every other car had from this era. It's like this weird key cut into a cylinder shape, and it's very unusual and very distinctive to Jaguar models from this time period. And next up, I'm about to climb inside, but before I do that, I want to stick with the theme of pushing the Jaguar logo. So I want to go to the trunk. Now you can see on the back of the trunklet, it says Jaguar across the center, J-A-G on one side, U-A-R on the other. In the center, you have the Jaguar logo, that Jaguar face. And to access the trunk, you press the Jaguar face and then the trunk unlatches and then you can lift it up from there. So they had some clever ways of gaining entry to this car, mainly involving pushing a Jaguar's head. And next we climb into the Super V8, and the first thing you're struck by is it's pretty nice in here. There is leather just about everywhere in this interior, but more notable is the wood pretty much everywhere. You can see the entire dashboard is awash in this beautiful patterned wood. Same deal with the center console area here. And on the steering wheel, you can see wood on the top and bottom, making this look especially luxurious. My favorite touches with the wood, one on the door panel, you can see the wood has this nice little trim line that matches it and looks very luxurious. Also, I like that you have wood trim even on the gear lever. You shift into gears by moving around this piece of wood that is very luxurious, very nice, as you would expect from a very expensive Jaguar. One other interesting item with the wood, over on the passenger side of the dashboard, the airbag cover is all wood, and you can see they've even integrated the airbag off warning light into the wood trim. You don't see that too often. Usually wood kind of stands alone. It rarely includes warning lights, but in the Jaguar, with all its wonderful wood, it does. But anyway, moving on to the rest of this interior, there are quite a few quirks and features in here, as you might expect, and I'm going to start in the center console with the gear lever. You can see the shift pattern is arranged in a J. That was intentional. They called it the J gate, and J stood for Jaguar. And this was Jaguar's bizarre answer to the manual transmission modes that a lot of automatics had at this time. A lot of the rivals to this car had like a plus minus mode on the automatic for shifting. In this car, if you wanted to shift, you were supposed to put the gear selector in 2, and then you could go manually through the rest of the gears, or you could downshift manually, going from 5 all the way down. That was their version of an automatic with a manual shift mode. Very strange, the J-gate, but a lot of Jags from this era had it. But anyway, next up, moving up to the center screen, I gotta say, the screen in this car isn't really as bad as you might think. For one thing, it's a touchscreen, which was actually pretty advanced for 2006. A lot of cars from this era were not using touchscreens, and you had to control the whole thing with like buttons on the side and a wheel, and it was a bit of a disaster. This has a touchscreen, which makes it way easier than most other screens from this era. But the real benefit of this screen is the fact that they duplicated basically every important control in an actual button. You have a climate section of this touchscreen, and as you can see, you can adjust all your climate functions here, but you also have hard buttons for all of the really important climate stuff. Same deal with the radio. There is an audio section of this screen that you can use, move around, change radio stations, whatever, but you can also do virtually all of that stuff using the hard buttons they have for the audio system in here. It's almost like Jaguar knew their customers would be really, really unsure about using a screen, so they were like, we're gonna give them a screen because it's a nice car, but we're also gonna give them backups of everything so they don't complain. Now, over in the gauge cluster, you can see there's no screen here. Still old school gauges, and they look fairly standard. I do like the fact that it says supercharged on the tachometer, and then it says supercharged again over on the gauge on the right, the fuel gauge, temperature gauge, says supercharged twice in the gauge cluster, just in case you really needed that reminder. Another interesting item in this vicinity, to the left of the steering wheel, you have a few controls. One of them is a button that changes from miles to kilometers with a simple push of a button, as if this is a feature you'll be needing to use very often. You tap that and it changes the odometer from miles to kilometers. I don't think most people will find this button very useful in most places, but I guess in the UK they use miles, and if you drive this car to mainland Europe, you'll want to switch easily to kilometers, so you can do it with the simple push of a button. Now, one other interesting button in this area is this car in a triangle. That turns on your forward collision alert system. That's a big deal. Back in 2006, virtually nothing had that feature. It was an early attempt at this forward collision warning, which is a feature we now take for granted. But this car, the ultra-luxury Jag, had it. And next up, another interesting quirk of this car. On the steering column, you have a power adjuster to move it up or down. A lot of luxury cars in this time period had that. The weird thing here, though, is when you move it up or down, it first makes a short move in the opposite direction, and then it does what you want. You can see, I'm pushing it down, it goes up a little, and then it goes down. I push it up, it goes down a little, then it goes up. And it does this every single time without fail. I have no idea why, but it's an old Jaguar, so some weirdnesses are to be expected. Next up, another quirk I liked on Jaguar models from this era, opening the glove box. You don't have some ugly plastic handle. Instead, you have this silver aluminum button, unlabeled, you just have to know. You push it and it opens, a much classier glove box opening than most other cars. And speaking of storage compartments up front, the center console is a little bit unusual. It's also a little bit damaged. It seems to me like the only thing that's broken on this entire car, but anyway, the upper part, you press this silver button and it reveals the cup holders, which is pretty standard. The weird part is the lower bit for this center console. You open it up and there's not really any storage here. You can see there's like no room to put anything, even though this is your center console storage area. It's kind of unusual to see that, but I suspect it has to do with Jaguar wanting this car to look sort of low and flat and muscular, so they needed to move the driveline up a bit, and that robbed some of your center console storage, and that was a casualty. Kind of a weird thing, but no real center console storage in the XJ Super V8. But beyond the interesting quirks, one last luxury feature worth mentioning up front. You go up to your overhead center console area with some buttons. You can see this area is trimmed in wood. You would expect nothing less from the Super V8. But anyway, the buttons here, this button controls the rear sunshade. You press this and the rear sunshade will go up or down to provide the rear seat passengers with a little bit more shade, a little bit more privacy as they're being chauffeured around in their Super V8. But since we're talking rear seat comfort, we might as well climb back here, because while the front seat has mostly typical ultra high-end luxury car amenities from this era, the rear seat has far more quirks and features. This is really where it's at. And that's proven the moment you get inside and sit down, you have a lot of room. This is the long wheelbase Jaguar XJ, and all of that extra wheelbase, about 5.5 inches, was added in the back. And so you can basically lie down back here and relax while you're being chauffeured along, and it is glorious. But just in case you do want to do stuff back here, there's a lot to do. For one thing, you can see folding tray tables. You push this little silver button and this wood tray table unfurls itself with this aluminum hinge. It's all very gorgeous. The top of the tray table is not wood. It's a different material for better durability in case you actually want to use it, but it is all very nice. You also have built-in rear screens. They're built into the backs of the front headrests, and you can see them here. Not too many luxury cars had this feature, short of like Rolls-Royce or Bentley, but the Super V8 did. Now, you might be wondering, how do you control the rear screens? Well, that's all done in here. This is the center console armrest. If you fold it up, you can see it becomes a middle seat, fairly standard. But when it's folded down, you can open up this front compartment, and you have a lot of controls in here. And you can see left and right controls, plus left and right volume controls to adjust the volume on either screen, depending which seat you're sitting in, which screen you're watching, and left and right headphone jacks. You also have red, yellow, white connectors in here, so you could stick in some sort of device, like a DVD player, in case you wanted to watch from that while you're being driven along in your Jag. That is a pretty nice luxury touch. Now, you will notice that in these controls, you also have, in the center of everything, a phone dial pad, all of your telephone numbers, and that's because you could connect your phone in this car and then sit back here with your headphone jack plugged in and start calling people, just dial in their numbers while you sit back here being chauffeured along, which was also obviously another nice luxury touch, especially back in 2006 when stuff like that just didn't really exist. And of course, there's more in the backseat of this Jag. For one, you can see some controls mounted on the back of the front center console. The most notable controls here are your climate controls. You have two individual rear zones, so rear passengers can adjust the temperature however they want individually, just like up front. And you have heated rear seats back here, left and right. You can turn them on and heat them and get even more comfortable in back. You can see in this area, you also have a little power plug. There's a little plug sign. You pull this off and you can plug in your devices to the cigarette lighter style outlet. And you have your own cigarette lighter back here. This one over on the left is a cigarette lighter for the rear seat passengers, so they don't have to share with the front. And yes, of course, this car has individual ashtrays. They are mounted on the rear doors. You can see one on the passenger side and over here, one on the driver's side as well. Two rear ashtrays and a rear cigarette lighter so you can smoke while you're being chauffeured along. Now, another cool feature you will find on the door panel, you can see right here next to the door handle, is seat memory, which is unusual to find in the back seat, except it makes sense here because these are power rear seats. You can see the power controls here. It only controls the backrest and then also the lumbar support, but still power operated rear seats, and you can position them how you like and set a memory function. So when you're riding back here, you just tap the memory and it goes back to your desired spot. And next up, a few other interesting items worth noting back here. For one, in the other part of this middle center console, you pop open the rear section, you can see cup holders and also a little storage back here, which further adds to your comfort. And I mentioned the rear window sunshade, which is power operated like I showed you. There are also sunshades on the doors for the side windows. These are manually operated, but you lift up this little piece and you can put the sunshade in place again to shield you from the sun and increase your comfort. Amazingly, this car even has a sunshade for this tiny little rear quarter window in case you really want to be shielded from the sun. Very nice attention to detail there. And next up, we move outside the Super V8, and back here you can see the badge that says Super V8. This was a rare car, like I said, combining the performance engine with the long wheelbase luxury body style. They didn't do it for too many years, and you don't see these badges too often. But anyway, I want to get into the trunk, so I press the Jaguar, the trunk pops itself open, and then I lift it. And you can see the trunk in this car is actually a little bit unusual. It's very large, but not very tall. You can see there's maybe only a foot or a little more of clearance between the trunk floor and the lid. That kind of mimics the general look of this car. It was sort of wide and low, intended to be more muscular and cat-like than other luxury sedans, and that's carried over into the trunk as well. Now, the only really interesting thing in the trunk, aside from its size and shape, is this little panel over on the left. You open this up and you can see a series of slots for CDs and DVD players. In here, you have the CD changer. It was mounted in the trunk, so you would put your CDs in here and then you control it from the front seat, switching between the CDs and the trunk. You also have two DVD players back here. One DVD slot is for the navigation system, for the navigation discs. The other DVD slot, I presume, is for the rear seat screens. So you'd have to load your DVD here before you could start watching it. Not really an ideal situation, but hey, you should have been happy that you had rear screens at all in a luxury sedan in 2006. That was a pretty cool feature. One interesting thing about the trunk, it's not power operated to close it. There's no button you press here to get it to close. Instead, you have to do it manually, which doesn't seem to make all that much sense for a car at this price point from this era. The trunk does have one cool feature though, and that would be soft closing. You can get the trunk near where it would latch, and then it will automatically electronically latch itself closed. And that means you don't have to slam the trunk to close it. Just get it near where it needs to go, you can close it softly, and the car will automatically do the rest. Very luxurious. And next up, we move under the hood. You can see the engine, which was a big deal for this car. Like I've been saying, for years, Jaguar had made a full-size, full luxury sedan, the XJ8L or the XJ12 or the Vandenpla, and they had also been making a high-performance version, the XJR, but the XJR was only a short wheelbase model, and those luxury versions never got that XJR engine. This was the first time it was combined, the big power plant and the big luxury car, and this really was the boss Jaguar at the time. This engine made about 400 horsepower, which was pretty good back in 2006. By comparison, the V12-powered BMW 7 Series in this era only had about 40 more horsepower, so this supercharged 8 really did compete with the best of the best. And this car was lighter than most by virtue of its aluminum construction, which most brands weren't using at the time. Now, the XJ Super V8 trim level gave this car its fantastic engine, but it also gave it these wonderful wheels, these 20-inch many spoke wheels, a detailer's nightmare, but they look so good and they are so distinctly Jaguar from this era, and I love. These are some of my very favorite stock wheels ever, and they give this car a truly gorgeous look. As for the look of this car, aside from the wheels, the design at the time it came out was criticized for being a little restrained. This was a totally new XJ model in 2004, but it kinda looked like the old one, just modernized a bit, and a lot of people wished they had gone for something a bit more radical, which Jaguar eventually did for the 2011 model year. That XJ was a complete clean sheet, looked totally new, whereas this one was sort of more of an evolution, even though this was a much better car than the prior XJ under the skin and in terms of technology. Two interesting quirks worth noting up front in terms of design. One, you have the leaping Jaguar hood ornament, like you always did on Jags from this era. You wouldn't settle for anything less. Another cool feature of this car in front, it has four headlight sprayers because it has two headlights on each side. So quad headlights means quad headlight sprayers for when they get dirty, and that's kind of a neat quirk. You don't see that too often. And so those are the quirks and features of the XJ Super V8. Now it's time to get it out on the road and see how it drives. All right, driving the XJ Super V8. Which was a ridiculous name. I guess in Europe this was sold as the Daimler Saloon, which was a famous name of old Jaguar models in like the 50s, 60s, even throughout the 70s, 80s. But in the States it was the Super V8. Now, my very favorite thing about this car is none of the stuff I have showed you already. It is actually the engine. You floor it and... Oh, I love how it feels. I love how it sounds. I have always loved the engine in this car. I drove an XJR from this generation ages ago, and I drove it a while, and I remember just absolutely loving the engine. And I was curious if today I would get in this car and feel the same way, even having driven, you know, in the years since, all these other special cars. And the answer is, yeah, I still do. This car does not have any sort of quick shifting dual clutch automatic, but it just has so much torque on demand that even a little bit of throttle, it gears down quickly and it seems to respond very quickly, and there's just so much power to give. And it is smooth power and it has a good V8 sound to it. I love this engine. Love, 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 love. It was my very favorite thing about Jaguar from this era. I also really liked how these cars looked, frankly. I was not a big fan of the prior generation XJ, although I did like the XJR. But beginning in 2004 with the redesign, again, the base model, not really that cool of a looking car, but the XJR, the Super V8, the top spec ones with big wheels, they had this kind of neat, sublime subtlety to them that Mercedes and certainly BMW at the time didn't have. And that was a really cool touch about this car. But mostly, I just love this powertrain. Responsive, sounds good, torquey. I mean, everything about it, I absolutely, truly, truly love, and I always have. This is probably one of my very favorite engines from this era. Not number one, but certainly among the best. Now, of course, there are drawbacks to this car. It's incredibly cheap to buy now. I suspect this sells the, I don't know, high teens, low 20s. That's where these things tend to be. Maybe even higher than that, honestly. The Super V8s are hard to find, and this one has low mileage, but obviously, the selling price is only part of it. These kind of have a reputation for poor reliability. Now, I owned a 2006 Range Rover that had some problems, but never anything catastrophic. And I actually think that Jaguar and Land Rover sort of got their act together in the mid-2000s for a period and lost it again. But anyway, I digress. I would go in with my eyes wide open buying this car, that you're still buying an old Jaguar. Instead of paying $100,000 and the car loses a lot of value, you're paying cheap, but you might spend a lot maintaining and repairing it over time. The other drawback about this car, to be totally honest, was the handling. The steering and handling wasn't really that great. You know, the thing about the Super V8 specifically was it was intended to be both the luxury car and have the performance engine, but there was a better performer, if that's what you really wanted, in the XJR. It was a shorter wheelbase car and it had sport suspension. This car had kind of the luxury suspension, it just happened to have the big engine. And so the result of that is you get the big engine and the big power, this engine that I absolutely love, but you don't really get the sporty, throw it around to whatever extent you could, driving experience of the XJR. It's not quite the same. And so this car, I mean, it's air suspension, it's tuned for comfort, it's tuned for luxury. This car is kind of a floatier luxury car. You're not buying this if you're intending to go around corners fast, even though it has this fast powertrain. Truthfully, my overall summary of this car is I think it's awesome. Really do. I think that these are impressive cars. I have always wanted to film an XJ from this era, but I wanted to wait for a really nice XJR or an XJ Super like this one, and that's what this is. They're just great. I love this powertrain. The technology is not so bad, especially for 06. You know, Bentleys were not using touchscreens in 06. This car was ahead of that. And I don't know, there's a lot of cool stuff, but especially this powertrain is cool, and I love the look of these cars. You just gotta understand, it might not be cheap to own one of these, even though it is a lot of car for the money. And so that's the Jaguar XJ Super V8. This thing still looks boss 15 years after it was new, and now it's a lot cheaper, at least to buy. And you can buy this one on Cars and Bids. Anyway, now it's time to give the XJ Super V8 a DOUGSCORE. Starting with the weekend categories and styling, the XJ Super V8 is a handsome car, attractive for a big sedan, and it gets a 6 out of 10. Acceleration does 0 to 60 in the low 5-second range, and it gets a 5 out of 10. Handling is fine, though not really that spry or sporty, since this car is more tuned for luxury, and it shows, and it gets a 4 out of 10. Fun factor is also fine, it's quite fast, but this isn't about fun, it's more the combination of speed and luxury, and it gets a 5 out of 10. Finally, cool factor, and these are very cool, though a bit subtle. Most enthusiasts don't know the Super V8, but it's still a powerful and beautiful Jaguar, and it still gets a 5 out of 10, for a total weekend score of 25 out of 50. Next up are the daily categories and features. The Super V8 is reasonably well equipped, nicely so for its time period, but starting to lag a bit by today's standards, and it gets a 5 out of 10. Comfort is excellent, and it gets an 8 out of 10. Quality is fine, the interior is really nice, but aging Jaguar reliability is always a bit of a scare, and it gets a 6 out of 10. Practicality is normal for a car like this, and it gets a 5 out of 10. Finally, value, and this car is an excellent one. High teens or low 20s, I think, buys you one of the most impressive Jaguar models of the last couple decades. It would score even higher, but reliability is a question, and it gets a 6 out of 10 for a total daily score of 30 out of 50. Add it up and the Doug score is 55 out of 100, which places it here against relevant cars. The XJ Super V8 hangs with everything else, and it even beats out a few good rivals. This is a neat car, and honestly, it's one of my favorite modern Jaguars, especially because of that fantastic engine.